Dear colleagues, let me start the next session. And we have a great speaker now with from the Seoul National University, the director of the Center of Higher Education and Knowledge Studies, Professor Jung Cheol Shin. Professor Shin is working in our field and is a well-known researcher. His interests include higher education management and knowledge society, higher education governance, and policies in the field. He's well known for the works on research universities and research productivity. The papers that cover the issues of academic productivity and academic profession, and also his regional expertise include East Asian higher education, including Korea, Hong Kong, Malaysia. We're glad to have you here. So please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Seminop. I appreciate to Maria and Isaac for hosting me to this important conference. And also, congratulations to Russian Higher Education Research Association for your successful international conference this year. And I hope that you have a bigger umbrella next year. Congratulations to. Okay, my topic is about challenges for research universities in knowledge society. Okay. Oh. Okay, I can use this. Yeah. The laser point is not working, so shall I move to that place and then give a presentation using the mouse? Because I would like to highlight some point.
Sorry. It's working.
It's working now?
Yeah.
But the highlight is not working. Laser point is not working, so I will sit here and then give you some my talks. Okay. The first topic is about the world-class university in context. And second one is knowledge and social development. Third one is social system for knowledge, education, and economy. The first one is social science research in social context. I bring the social context in my presentation because I think the social contribution of knowledge production in social science, the social context is very critical. So I will a little bit elaborate this based on my own data in South Korea. Here, university has been developed from two different ideas. One idea is elitism. The other idea is egalitarianism. The elite university is basically based on elitism idea, and then it developed to the mass higher education. And now we are entered already post-massification in Russia and in many countries. However, we are still talking about the elite ideas. Here we have world-class university ideas, but there are big gaps between world-class university and post-massified higher education. The post-massification means all the high school graduates, all the secondary school graduates have a chance to study colleges. So they are underprepared in terms of academic preparation. However, the world-class university means we are pursuing to be an elite university in the world. So the elitism idea is conflict with the egalitarianism idea. Here, we are in very complex situation. I would call it as a complexity. As you know, the Clark called the modern university as a multiversity because teaching, research, and service function, these are all getting together and provide some complex organizational forms in the U.S. Higher education. I think it is now we are in complexity, not multiversity, much more complicated. Why we are so much complicated? We are in the conflict between teaching and research. We are in the conflict between public and private values, as Simon Marginson talked. Conflict between public and private resources, and between quality and quantity, and between global and local context. So these are all make us be very complicated now in higher education. Let me talk about the higher education development from different perspective. As I mentioned, from elite stage to mass stage, from mass stage to post-mass. Can you see this from here? Okay. I see the arrow here, but you don't see it. So, no problem. Take your time. Okay. No, you see, now you see. From elite to higher education to mass, from mass to post-massification. Here, during the elite higher education, the student academic preparation level was quite high because they are top talented student, but we did not have much knowledge to teach them. That means good professor means the professor who produced a lot of cutting-edge knowledges. So here, knowledge level is quite lower, but student preparation level is high. Now we are entered the post-massification. We have too much knowledge that we produced by the academics or researchers, but student academic preparation level, the level was relatively lower. So we are in trouble now. One strategy to address this issue is to apply division of labor between research and teaching. So you can recruit research-only professors. On the other hand, you also recruit the teaching-only professors. Through the division of labor, you can make a harmony of teaching and research in your university. But here, during the mass higher education stage, we were thinking about how to harmonize teaching and research by individual professors or by individual academic units. That's why we developed many managerial reforms during the mass higher education. Now our concern is not the managerial reform. Now many of us are thinking about how to satisfy the underprepared student. Here, I briefly compared how the three-stage difference between elite, mass, and post-massification. Who are the main actors in the elite higher education? Professors. Their knowledge production was very important. Massification, academic managers. Now, student. How to satisfy student is your issue. Core value, excellence, assuring quality assurance, student satisfaction. Keyword, for a professor, academic freedom is important. Academic manager, management, managerial efficiency. For a student, college, etc. During our 3 days of presentation, we talked a lot about the rankings. We have QS ranking, Times, and also Raiden ranking, and Shanghai Jiaotong rankings. If you ask me which ranking I can trust the Raiden ranking, but may not other rankings, because the Raiden ranking publicly released their own raw data, but the other ranking, they provide you only weighted data. So you cannot use the weighted data for your research purpose. But Raiden ranking provide raw data. According to this ranking survey in this year, most of them are from OECD countries. These are red color is non-OECD countries. Here, English-speaking countries and non-English-speaking countries, European countries. I provide this slide because the ranking status depends on whether you speak English or not, whether you are in Europe or other countries. As you can see here, according to Raiden ranking, it is relatively equally distributed. That means Russian university has more chance to be highly ranked in Raiden ranking, but may not in QS or Times or Shanghai Jiaotong rankings. Give you some more information about the contextual difference between countries. In terms of teaching in a foreign language, according to CAP data, as you see, UK, US, Australian colleagues, professors, they do not teach a lot of courses in foreign language. They teach the courses only in English. Here, Korea, Netherlands, or Germany. We work hard to teach students in other than mother tongues. Publishing foreign language. Here, UK, US, Australia, they are not publishing much in foreign languages. But with the other countries, we work hard to publish in other languages, English, which is English. See here. International collaboration, UK, US, UK, Australia, Netherlands, they are collaborating a lot with the other countries. Published with international colleagues, UK, US, they do not publish much with international colleagues here. So, according to this brief descriptive data, although UK, Australia, and US academics, they do not teach in other languages, and they do not publish in other languages, but their ranking status is relatively higher than other system. What's that mean? The global ranking measures whether you use English or no, whether your university is in the Western society or no, something like that. So think about that dimension. Here, I briefly overview the conceptual difference between world-class university and national-class university and local-class university. What is world-class university? World-class university is basically for the betterment of the human being in general. But national-class university means the university is for national development. Local-class means university for local community development. When we talk about university and economic development in Russia or in other countries, that means we are talking about the national class university, not the world class university. This brings a lot of difference between different type of ideas. So if you are focusing on the world class university, you might be interested in basic, pure research. If you are interested in national class university, you might be interested in applied and pure, both together. Local class, maybe applied is much more important than pure research, something like that. Okay, knowledge and social development. If we produce new knowledge, then we can use the knowledge for practice development. We call it the application for industrial development or for your policy development. Also, we can use the theory or new knowledge in your classroom for teaching. These will be feedback to the new knowledge development in the future. So these are kind of cycle. Let me give you a little bit comprehensive view. Here, you create new knowledge, and then the new knowledge could be used for your economic development or education development or to the new knowledge production. Let's say these should be all harmonized, interrelated each other. Let's say if your economy is not based on high-tech industry, but let's assume one professor who is very productive in high-tech some area, technology development, and he or she teaches their student in the classroom. But if your economy is not based on high-tech industry, what happened? Many people will lose their job, right? So this is a kind of ecosystem, knowledge ecosystem. Knowledge creation, knowledge application, teaching, integration. These are all interrelated together. That's why your knowledge production should be based on your own context, your education context, your economic production context, or your knowledge production context. Knowledge production is not a context neutral. So context is very important in my presentation. Let me think about how to measure your contribution to your society through the knowledge production. Here, we have research here. And then you do a lot of research. And then here's the output, publication or patent. Here's the first impact, knowledge transfer or technology transfer. Your social impact. How can we measure your social impact of your knowledge production in your own society? Here, we assume that if people work together in other disciplines or in other countries, they have more chance to contribute to your own society. That's why we measure the collaboration in your ranking scheme, especially in writing ranking. Here, we measure the publication or patent. Here, we measure citation. These are all in the your ranking schemes, in many ranking schemes. Here is a research collaboration measured by triple helix. Some of you already knew that the triple helix model proposed by Henjeskovich and Reidestrup. And the theory applied in Korean context through the 1970s through 2010. And this one means collaboration has been increased during this period. But this means collaboration has been decreasing now. Although we publish many, many papers in international journals, and also although we registered many, many patents in international patent offices. This negative sign, yes, positive sign. We can apply the collaboration in this through in ranking or measuring dynamics of industrial dynamics of knowledge production in your own society through the using the triple helix model. Let's say I'm going to talk about the social context. Why social context is very important? There are some perspective on the using foreign knowledge in Korea or in Russia. You may import many many knowledges from abroad and then use the knowledge to understand your own selves, right? Here, one skeptical perspective is academic dependency. It is not good to rely only on the foreign knowledges. Yes, academic imperialism. We want to publish many, many papers. We want to produce many knowledges. But it is not allowed by international publication mechanism like some journal mechanisms. So it's a negative perspective. However, we have also a positive perspective. If you learn foreign knowledge and apply the foreign knowledge into your own society, then the knowledge contributes to your own society. That's the benefit. Okay? We have competing two knowledges. Difference between three systems. I'm going to briefly talk about how education, economy, and knowledge production system differ across European system, American system, or Northeast Asian system. In terms of education in European system, you input a lot of your resources into secondary education. In American system, higher education. In Northeast Asian system, we developed our education system from elementary to secondary, from secondary to higher education. So incremental approach. In terms of economy, in Europe still you have a strong manufacturing sector. In American system, high-tech, finance, management sector. In North America, Northeast Asians, we are transforming from the manufacturing to high-tech industry now. In knowledge production system, in European system, in-house research is much stronger than university research. However, in the American system, university is the center of innovation here. In Northeast Asian, we're trying to develop our system from in-house to university research system. It is too much brief, generalized explanation, but it will give you some ideas about why I am thinking about the contextualization in knowledge production. I have some evidence to support my argument here. Education system and expenditure in between countries. If you see the USA, they input a lot of money in higher education, elementary, secondary, and higher education. However, in Germany and France or Switzerland, you use too much money on secondary education. It will support my first argument. How about economic production systems? According to the NSF data set here, we have value added for all manufacturing industries, value added for total service. Here we have value added for high-tech and knowledge industries. In Korea, these three sectors, three areas are well equally distributed. But in the USA, see, here high-tech only and also service industry only. The manufacturing is relatively small in terms of GDP production. France and Germany, here you see the difference between countries. USA, UK, Australia, these countries are basically based on the service or high-tech industry-based economic production system. In terms of knowledge production by countries, according to OECD data, here is pure research, applied research, and development research. In the USA, much share of the research is conducted in the development research. Japan, also Korea, also development research. Australia, you are equally distributed between three types of research, France, Norway. These countries means these countries have a stable ground of pure research. But in Korea or in Japan or US, we have some trouble in pure research. Social context between academic disciplines here, contribution to your national economy or your society, contextualization. Social science and engineering, both areas are much more contextualized compared with the art and humanities. Let me explain again. In terms of contribution to your national economy, natural science, here natural science, here social science, engineering, both have more chance to contribute to your own society in terms of economic development. However, art and humanity and natural science, they're relatively lower chance. In terms of contextualization, social science and engineering, they have much more, should be expected to be more contextualized within your own society. Here, I measure the levels of contextualization by percentage of earned PhD in foreign countries and by percentage of publication in foreign countries. In Korean case, humanity, social science, engineering, natural science. The natural science is pretty much globalized. Most of the Korean scholars, they received a degree from foreign countries, over 40%. Relatively low percentage of the publication from in the social science and humanities in foreign countries. So you see that these are a little bit globalized, these are a little bit domestically produced. Comparison between 19 systems that participated in the CAP survey, same variable here, percentage earned in foreign countries, percentage of publication in foreign countries. Hong Kong is here, USA is here, Korea is here, but UK. I think these are good for your own country because you educate your own researchers and also your publication is based on your own context and publish it within your own country. That's a good sign to me in terms of contextualization. Dimensions of social context in social science. Let me think about how each system approaches social science from their own perspective. In European society, according to my observation, your theme is basically theoretical themes. You handle you are very much interested in theoretical themes. But in Anglo-American system, maybe practical themes. In Confucian system, we are thinking about whether the theory or practice applicable in our own context. We are interested in this dimension. In terms of research approach in European, theoretical research focused, in Anglo-American, empirical research focused. In our context, we are interested in both theoretical or empirical. If I want to publish in, let's say, in the USA, probably practical issue will be good topic to publish. If I want to publish in European context, maybe strong theory-based paper will be fit to the European context. In terms of implication, in European scholars, they are pretty much interested in theory development. In Anglo-American system, practice development, here we both. So I'm trying to explain you why we are different. We are different between systems. I'm going to present some empirical research based on my contextualization argument. I chose political science, economics, sociology and education in South Korea. I chose two representative journals in each area. Here, when they began to publish their paper and the impact factor in Korean, according to Korean impact factor calculation, number of articles during last three decades. Use of foreign knowledge. We can measure the use of foreign knowledge, whether they cite foreign journal or foreign books in their reference, or whether they cite domestic reference in their citation. So reference analysis will be used for two major use of foreign knowledge. And second one is contextualized implication through your research. Here, theoretical discussion without Korean context, theoretical discussion with Korean context, practical discussion without Korean context, practical discussion with Korean context, practical discussion with policy development ideas in it. So I coded the journal, each journal articles according to this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 categories. Use of domestically developed knowledge. In political science, they use only 30% of the resources from Korean journal, Korean domestically produced journals or articles. In economics, 31%. Sociology, about 40%. Education, 44%. Majority of the reference are from the English-based journals, English-based articles or books. Here, about 60%, 65, 53, and 52. That means our social science research relying on English-based knowledge. Some people also cite Japanese resource, German resource, or French resource, but basically English is the major one. I'm mainly interested in the contrast between Korean and English, because Korean represents domestically produced knowledge, and English is a foreign knowledge to me. See the changing trend in political science. You see, here is English journals, English knowledge. Here is Korean knowledge. Both trends were converging during the late 1980s, but now it's diverging. That means Korean political scientists, they bring a lot of ideas from foreign production, foreign knowledges. Here, economics, same. You can find the same trend. We are diverging here. In sociology, it's kind of up and downs in terms of domestic knowledge use. See? I think sociologists try to explain social phenomena in Korea based on social own theory, but they pretty open a borrow idea, theoretical ideas from abroad. That's why it's up and down trend. You can find it. For education, see the reversed trend. That means in the field of education studies, we use a lot of domestic knowledges to explain our own education development in Korea. It's interesting. The other variable is contextualization of research implication. As I told you, I coded 1 through 5. Here in political science, you see the 21% is academic discussion without context. Academic discussion with context, 22%. Practical discussion without context. Practical discussion with context. Practical discussion with policy development. Here you see the education field of education. We try to bring up policy implication from our own research compared more policy implication than other areas. You see here, practical discussion with context. This means education research is basically relatively based on Korean knowledge compared to other areas. Simple conclusion. In terms of social implication, we have low social implication, high social implication. in terms of use of domestically produced knowledge, no low level, high level in education. I think we have almost built up our own knowledge hubs. But in economics, they are talking about the foreign knowledges. That's why they are in this column and is called globalized research. In sociology, their social implication is relatively low because many sociologists like the theoretical discourse rather than the practical one. That's why they are low in terms of social implication. However, they use many domestically produced knowledge. In political science, they do not talk a lot about the social implication in their study, and they don't use a lot of domestically produced knowledge. So it's a kind of dependent research in my typology. It's interesting, I think. This is about my presentation. Thank you very much.